Now, earlier in the program, I showed you the evening newspaper that I picked up on this tube here, the subway. And right at the top of the Evening Standard, Raducanu's fairy tale of New York. Emma blasts away rival to reach the US Open at the age of 18. It is the most exciting headline out of the US Open so far. Two unseeded teenagers making it to the women's final. Emma Raducanu from the UK faces off against Canada's Leila Fernandez. It happens on Saturday. It's going to be the first US Open final between two teens since 1999. And yes, in the men's final, by the way, Novak Djokovic is going to be closer to a calendar Grand Slam. The first time that's happened in more than five decades. So the men are making news, but by far the more exciting bit, perhaps at the moment, just is with the women. Because in 1999, Serena Williams defeated Martina Hingis. Williams actually had to miss out this time because of a leg injury. This year, the competition has also been marked by COVID-19 and also had to manage the remnants of Hurricane Ida. Stacey Alistair is the US Open Tournament Director, joins me now via Skype. We've talked before, Stacey. This one is different. It feels different on both sides.
You know, everyone has said to me, this has been the most exciting US Open in history, I would say, in a very long time. And there is so much magic happening here. I think fans are just so thrilled to be back on site at the USTA Billie Jean King National Tennis Center in Arthur Ashe. The athletes have said there is nothing like playing on a 24,000 seat stadium with really energetic fans. And the athletes have delivered and the fans have just loved it.
Do you think that there is more ease within tennis over the issue now of mental health and the way the industry? I mean, following on from the French and the Olympics and what we have seen, is there within tennis itself, is there a feeling that something is being done?
Absolutely. And Richard, you know, the WTA has had a long time program around athlete care and including mental health. At the U.S. Open, we launched a U.S. Open mental health initiative. And really, it came off the reality that the pandemic has had a dramatic impact on all athletes. 35% of professional athletes in general are suffering from mental health and just the sort of this subculture that we work in with the dimensions of sport. So we added a licensed mental health provider to our healthcare team. Mm-hmm. We had Marty Fish, an American athlete who publicly struggled with anxiety, here on our courts as an ambassador. The addition of quiet rooms and recovery rooms, place for them to go and decompress, and really looked at the overarching, when an athlete has a health condition, including mental health, how are we going to make those adjustments for them?
The one interesting thing, besides a corker of a final in both regards, but the other interesting thing is the number of people who are playing tennis. Now, I have to say, I'm not one of them, and you really don't want me anywhere near.
We've got to change that, Richard. Well, there's hope even for you.
You've been promising that for a few years, and maybe there is hope post-pandemic. But more people are playing. I mean, there is a social distancing element to it. You can't get too close because of the net in the middle. But why do you think tennis has taken on a popularity?
Well, I do think here in the United States, with 4 million new players in 2020, and you could see this arc of increased participation from the U.S. Open into Q4 last year. It is a very safe sport. It is low cost. And we had this two-week U.S. Open last year as a marketing platform to inspire Americans to come out and play our sport. We had people who hadn't played in many years who came back, and new ones. Your racket sales increased 143%. And that's just incredible. Ball sales. People can't get balls, tennis balls, right now here in our country. So, you know, this pandemic has been difficult on many people. certainly for our sport, we have been able to benefit from it and optimize the interest of our consumers here in the US.
Stacey, I know that you will be neutral in the women's final.
We won't tell anyone I'm Canadian, right, Richard?
You are. I am not neutral tomorrow. I'm going to just say.
No,
the Brit, I'm going to be rooting for the Brit, and I'll leave you to the Canadians and have to sort that out.
I have to be neutral. But it's,
of course
it's it's a fairy tale here. Everyone said, could you imagine if we had the two teenagers in the final, and I just did not allow myself to think it, the, Sabalenka, number two player in the world, Zachary, though, Emma and Layla, man, have they fought their way to this opportunity. Amazing.
Thank you.